conflict at other times. Our region is intrinsically conflict prone because people are ready to fight for what they firmly and fervently believe in. Our leaders are intrinsically peaceful because they are spiritually oriented and the religious worldviews and precepts includes ideas such as inner peace, non-violence and calm meditation. Any effort to actually essentialize religion in general or specific religion as conflict prone or peacefully bound to be invalid imperial. What is perhaps more useful is to examine under what circumstances religious or some religious actors turn to violence and what makes religious place advocate for peace and mutual coexistence. Like most countries in the South Asian region, Sri Lanka was faced with the balance, the expectation of majority and the minority communities, vice versa, as to power and resources in the post-colonial period. The island experienced several tensions and rights between the majority and minority ethnic religious communities in the post-colonial period. The militarization of radical Tamil minority youth groups was to result in South Asia's bloodiest post-colonial armed conflict waged over quarter centuries from 1982 to 2009 by the LPP for a separate state in the Tamil-speaking northern eastern regions. The confrontation between the state and the LGD resulted in the further ethnicization of public religion and culture. For in the post-colonial period, communal or what are now termed ethno-racial or national identities were mapped onto the conception of race, thereby changing existing identity configurations. What is clear is that the linguistic and religious categories have been consolidated along an ethno-racial fold in post-colonial Sri Lanka. This despite the fact that the Hindus and Buddhists share many common religious practices, they are viewed as belong to different regions. This paper aims to show how plural worship helps reconciliation in the post-war Sri Lanka and to stress the importance of regaining multicultural past. So I emphasize the regaining multicultural past of the country. Let me explain this by the paying attention to a body of literature produced on major religious science in Sri Lanka by both local and foreign anthropologists. That is my view. So there are a number of anthropological sociological works on major religious or pilgrimage centers in Sri Lanka. With regard to Buddhist science, notably works of includes H.S. Ratna's at the temple of the Tuthulik of the Buddhas in the capital city of the former Kandy Kingdom, Dharana of the Vegetables at the Devi Shrine of Katragama in the southern province, Elizabeth Nisan at the Anuradhapura, the first capital of pre-colonial Sri Lanka, Jonathan Waters' work on Kalinga near the capital city of Colombo, and Mihindale in Anuradhapura, Stephen Kemper at Sevavita in eastern province, and my own recent study from Sri Pada. The work of Krahamberger, Vinata, Padmanathan and Bastian on Hindu pilgrimage sites is also notable here, as is document on Catholic pilgrimage sites and Dennis McGilvery on Sufism and Muslim saints shrine in Sri Lanka. Yet, there are more important pilgrimage centers and shrines, both Buddhist and Hindu, even Catholic and Islamic, to be studied in the country. Each of these pilgrimage centers has a major annual festival. Similarly, each center has developed its own patterns of religiosity. For example, Katragama shows more expressive form of worship, practicing bhakti devotionalism. The Katragama pilgrimage is notable for that fact that expressive form of worship at the site was originally and almost exclusively concerned of Tamil Hindus and Vaidyas. The recent involvement of similar pilgrims in more expressive form of bhakti devotionalism at Katragama is one of the key themes which Obeysekar has explored in his study. But the majority of pilgrims going to Katragama do not engage in any externalized devotional religious activities. Their primary activities is making and fulfilling vows by making various kinds of offering to the god. Katragama can be identified as a place of plural worship where Buddhists, Hindus, Islam and Catholic devotees are visibly engaged in their their religious activities. In contrast to the religious state of Katharagam pilgrims, Elizabeth Nisan's studies in the sacred city of Anuradhapura has shown a different type of religiosity. Pilgrims go to the sacred city mainly for worshipping and to obtain merit, emphasize restraint and calm in physical and emotional manner. Their actual life's actual devotionalism is absent. An attitude of internalized devotion is appropriate for such pilgrimage. Anuradhapura is a predominantly a Buddhist site, and people belong to other religions do not play a part in the religious activities at the center. The pilgrims to the temple of the Cook relief in Kenya are different from Anuradhapura and Katharagam. According to the Seviratna, pilgrims come to see the great annual pageant of the former Mandalay kingdom, while many pilgrims make offering in the temple of the Cook as well. People belonging to other regions also visit the temple, just as visitors of historically and culturally important places in the country, but not as devotees. Unlike Anuradhapura and Kandy, devotees come to Munneswara, according to Bastian, to engage in non-merit-making activities, such as the practice of sorcery and counter-sorcery rites, and seek elevations from misfortune and other forms of suffering which are hard to find at other religious sites in the country. This Tamil Sai Mai temple is open to all single Buddhists, Tamil Hindus, Roman Catholics and Islamic people. Munneswara is also a remarkable place of a Tamil Sai Mai temple with predominantly single Buddhist patronage, which prevented even during a period of ethnic violence between Tamil and Sinhala. Bastian's study has revealed that the Hindu temple is reproduced as a center of worship amidst of conflict and competition and a degree of religious tolerance that see both communities actually worshipping together. Stephen interprets the shift of devotional interest of Sinhala Catholicism pilgrims from the other, older and specific shrine to the new personal centered cult. In general, Stewart explores how attendance of special Catholic shrine enables the reinterpretation of fragmented individual experience and diverse groups. Of the many Catholic shrines in Sri Lanka, two stand out from all the others as being particularly popular not only among Sinhalese and Tamil Catholics, but also among Buddhists and Hindus as well. These shrines are Saint Anne's at Palavida and Our Lady Madhu in Manana, which are claimed by some to be shrines previously sacred to Hindus or Buddhist deities. According to the spirit, many Catholics accept the existence of Hindu and Buddhist gods, and their healing rituals are clearly modeled on those single Buddhists in both forms and content. Catholic saints being substitute for Buddhist gods. Therefore, the religiosity of such Catholics owe more to single Buddhism than to the Church of Rome. All these pilgrimage centers are of national significance and draw large crowds. Kandy and Anuradhapura being almost exclusively Buddhist, while Katharagam, Munneswara and Sripadu draw pilgrims from all of Sri Lanka's religious groups, predominantly Buddhist and Hindus, but also Muslim and Catholics. These centers have not all been equally important in the past. However, due to the low-country Buddhist revivalist activities in the latter part of the 19th century, most of the pilgrimage centers have become more national significance. For example, pilgrimage centers like Anuradhapura raised its prominence during the colonial era and has been recreated as a national heartland since independence of Sri Lanka. Okay, now, let me briefly talk about my own work, Sripada. Sripada is a major pilgrimage site in the country that is also known in the English-speaking world by its anglicized name, Adam's Peak. This tropical forest mountain territory is said to be protected by the god Sama, considered the guardians of Sripada. Historically speaking, Sripada is a remarkable place of worship for people belonging to all four major religions in Sri Lanka, where they share one particular object of worship. One particular object of version. The sacred footprint, but with specific interpretation from their own religious traditions. As Nisarana and Sri point out, in pre-colonial state, ethnic, religious and linguistic differences were not used as a basis for inclusion or exclusion from the polity. At various times, groups would speak alternative languages, adhere to alternative religion, and claim alternative identities. As Stanley Thambaya, Benedict Anderson and Burton Sane show, the pre-modern state of South and Southeast Asia, despite variation in detail, emerged as a relatively loosely structured organization built upon the basis of heterogeneity, relativity and gradually and on the ideals of the delegation of power from the center. This Sen Gerard Thambaya described as, I quote and unquote, galactic polity. And Burton Sane formulated as, I quote and unquote, segmental state. In my view, such differences were evidently tolerated at the pre-colonial Sri Mother, which had been continuously patronized by the pre-colonial state. Though Buddhist monks had controlled the Sri Mother temple and Buddhist kings lavishly patronized it, alternative religious beliefs and practices were never excluded from pre-colonial Sri Mother. Instead, they were accommodated and recognized. Like other major religious sites in Sri Lanka, thousands of pilgrims annually make the journey to Sri Mother to worship the sacred footprint. In the past, many people came there with the intention of acquiring religious merit, and indeed today they receive for many reasons. The main pilgrimage normally takes place during the month of December to May. However, the busiest part of the year extends from February to April, with the peak of the pilgrimage season during the festival of Magdalene Pool Moon Poete in March. According to the police estimation, during the year 2000-2001, where I did my actual field work, number of pilgrims climbed Sri Mother was 2.2 million. A figure that, if true, would indicate that 1/8 of total population of Sri Lanka visits Sri Mother, such a popular place. The historical development of the site showed how different Sri Mother temples have constructed, reconstructed, or ordered or reordered under different powers at different historical moments in temple history. It is also evident that the Sri Mother has been historically viewed as a multi-ethnic, multi-religious site, and how that multiple discursive and non-discursive practices have been contested, marginalized, with the insurgence of Singaporean nationalism, particularly in post-colonial Sri Lanka. Though all sort of bitter dispute, contestation, antagonism and exclusion have been transpired in the official domain at the Sri Mother temple, the continued attractions of the larger number of pilgrims, mainly from peasants and the working class backgrounds of all nominal religious affiliation, is remarkably impressive. Obviously, the majority count is represented by the single Buddhists, the largest religious group in the island. Unlike other Buddhist pilgrimage sites on the island, such as Kandy, Anuradhapura, Munneswaram and Kapalagama, Sri Mother pilgrimage has never been abandoned. Despite the political difficulties that have arisen, since it was first institutionalized as a popular pilgrimage site during the kingship of Vijay Bhava I in early 12th century. So that is where actually Sri Mother was recognized by the state, right? It has been there for even before the Vijay Bhava. But the political recognition actually started from Vijay Bhava the first. The factors that have affected the attendance numbers and led to occasional breaks in Sri Mother's popularity have been insurgencies, outbreaks of epidemics, and unexpected weather conditions. Pilgrimage to Sri Mother has otherwise remained a popular attraction to many people of Sri Lanka, regardless of their religious faith. The impact of such aforementioned factors on the popularity of other pilgrimage sites in no way compatible with that of Sri Mother pilgrimage. It has been continuing for a long period without interruptions. The Sripada that was created in the decades of the independence, that does not represent the return to any original condition that it inherits. Rather, it was new creation, a predominantly Buddhist phase, a very concrete manifestation of Karma ideas of single Buddhist nationalism. Like Khatragama, the strong Buddhist elements at today's Sripada continues to grow. The small number of pilgrims who are representing non-Buddhist religious communities are still present at the Sripada temple as subordinate groups to Buddhism. The paradox of politics and nationalism in modern Buddhist politics is particularly acute in Sri Lanka, a historically multicultural and multi-faith island where four great world religions, Buddhism, Hinduism, Islam and Christianity, a range of indigenous spirit beliefs and astrology have coexisted for centuries. Though the island Sinhalese majority, who are mostly Buddhist, have been a part of ethnic linguistic conflict with the Tamil, who are mainly Hindus in post-colonial period. Most Buddhists pay homage to Hindu deities and Buddhist temples have Hindu signs. Indeed, religious coexistence and hybridity among Sinhala Buddhists and Tamil Hindus in everyday religious practices has been as much as uniform and bridging factors between these communities as a dividing one since the rise of post-colonial Sinhala Buddhist nationalism. Though the post-colonial conflict on the island is primarily ethno-linguistic, public religion or Sinhala Buddhist nationalism has been used by a range of political actors to marginalize religious minorities. I have explained this point to the case of Sripada temple, particularly how Sripada was a historical base of plural worship at the advent of Sinhala Buddhist nationalism in post-colonial Sri Lanka. So actually I have a slide that Anyway, so I just want to actually show you some pictures, but unfortunately it's not possible. Anyway, Sri Lanka's multicultural diversity and complex mix of identity is unique. Most South Asian nations are plural, diverse and complex. However, in the post-colonial period, diversity has been perceived as a threat rather than a gift. The result has been marginalization and discrimination against small and less powerful groups for linguistic, ethnic, religious, caste or class basis, giving rise to various forms of violence, political conflict. Since independence, however, there has been a failure to define and realize an inclusive national vision from the perspective of this distinctive heritage. Instead, competitive ethnic and religious politics became institutionalized. In this paper, I have described Sri Lanka's one religious nature through its major religious signs, but made a case for the idea that some regions in the country have or currently have an eminent position in respect to the other region, as they have enjoyed at different times a favored relation with the political power. This favored relations has not always been a strict correspondence between state and religion. So far, for as I showed, actually during the pre-colonial and even colonial period, with the Sripada temple example, the state was quite receptive to the existing social and religious diversity of the country, but that receptiveness began to be challenged when national culture was increasingly dominated by a highly politicized and organized Sinhala Buddhist party. That receptivity was, however, first challenged by the Portuguese Catholic, who transformed this situation by destroying temples and eventually evicting Muslims from low country regions. But then they gave way to the Protestant Dutch, who themselves gave way to the increasingly secular bureaucratic British, who created the colonial state and the native bourgeois that inherited power and a plantation economy, as well as a religiously revitalized diverse society that has increasingly demanded that the majority religion be granted the former space.